This song says, every praise is due our God. Hallelujah. Come on, let's just call our hands to Jesus.
Amen.
Every praise is to my God.
on. Come on.
You know, when you're using somebody else's phone, it's real hard. Y'all, I got a bootleg phone. I don't know, you can work up in here.
Come on.
And I don't know what happened. I'm just trying to be sure. And I found a baby. She's officially my assistant and a usher. Praise the Lord, saints.
It's probably an iPhone. Probably an iPhone.
It's probably an iPhone. Mm-hmm.
Probably an iPhone.
Mm-hmm. Oh, Lord. All right. Hallelujah. How many of you know because of who he is? He deserves all of our praise and all of our worship.
Amen. Amen.
Did you come to bless him? Not because of what he's done, but because of who he is. Yeah. If you just came to worship this morning, why don't you lift your hand and say, because of who you are, God, I worship you. Hallelujah, Jesus. That's right.
Worship you, because of who you are. Leave when you finish.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Welcome to Word Movers. Welcome to Word Movers, Harborside, 10 o'clock service. On behalf of Pastor Q, welcome to Word Movers, those online and those here in person. I have a few things before we get started with what I'm going to say. So Jay, thank you for the selections, and anybody that wants to join so that we can have a choir or just worshiping, have to get in touch with either Pastor Q, me, or somebody in the church. So anybody online that wants to join and be a part of our ministry of singing, then just let us know. Reach out to Jack. Yeah. See you after service. What about the people online?
They can reach out to
you. Okay. So people online, if you want to be a part of our worship and service, see Jay or get in touch with somebody in the congregation. Let me see. I put my glasses on. Okay, everybody's sick. Our members are sick. I call out names, and sometimes I forget people, but I don't want to forget anybody. But anybody that's sick, you just know that from Word Movers, we want you to get better. And when you do, come on back out and worship with us. Those online also. Okay. Okay, our women's ministry is on the move once again. So we're going bowling again to Bolero, Alexandria, Virginia. The last time we went, we had a wonderful time. And we're going to have that again. So we're going bowling at Bolero in Alexandria, Virginia, Saturday coming up from 4 to 6. So anybody that wants to participate, the same thing. Get in touch with Pastor. Well, get in touch with me or somebody in the church. It's a sign-up sheet in the back for those here that want to participate. So that's Bolero in Alexandria, Virginia, 4 to 6, Saturday coming up. That's for online too, if you want to. And okay, this is the last thing. Yeah, I know what I want to know. Smiling, everybody's smiling. Did y'all tell somebody God was good this week?
Oh yeah.
Did you? It don't sound like you did.
Oh yeah.
That's right, because God is good, and that's good participation. So that's good. Did y'all online tell somebody God was good? Because He is. Did you pass the pew? Because you're the pastor, did you do it? Okay, so that's all I have. I'm going to get started. What I'm going to talk about today is all that you need. God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. Psalm 73, verse 26. All that you need. Seated at the dining room table, I gazed at the happy chaos around me. Aunts, uncles, cousins, nieces, and nephews were enjoying the food and being together at our family reunion. I was enjoying it all too, but one thought pierced my heart. You're the only woman here with no children, with no family to call your own. Many single women like me have similar experiences. In my culture, Asian culture, where marriage and children are highly valued, not having a family of one's own can bring a sense of incompleteness. It can feel like you're lacking something that defines who you are and makes you whole. That's why the truth of God being our portion is so comforting. When the tribes of Israel were given their allotments of land, the priestly tribe of Levi was assigned none. Instead, God promised that He Himself would be their portion and inheritance. They could find complete satisfaction in Him and trust Him to supply their every need. For some of us, the sense of lack may have nothing to do with family. Perhaps we yearn for a better job, a higher academic achievement, or a significant other. Regardless of our circumstances, we can embrace God as our portion. He makes us whole, He and only Him, and in Him we have no lack. So, we all have something in life that we wish we could have, just that one thing. And we all say that if we just had this or if we just had that, that would make us whole or that would make us complete. But that's not true. The only thing in this life that will make us whole and sustain us is our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who made the heaven and the earth, who has the whole world in His hand. That's the only thing that's going to sustain us. Yeah, we might have that, we might get that man or that woman, the thing that we want so bad, but that is not going to keep us. That's not going to sustain us. Cash, money, cars, that's not going to sustain us. The only thing that's going to sustain us is our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. And that comes with us being connected to Him. Like I always say, staying connected to Him, because He will give us the desires of our heart, and He will give us a peace that surpasses all understanding. No man, no woman, no child is going to give you the peace that He's going to give you. He will give you that. Nobody else. And the Bible says that He will supply our every need according to His riches and glory, not our every want. So He is the only one that will do it if you just trust Him and let Him do it. Amen.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Today's scripture reading will come from 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 6 through 10. And that's 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 6 through 10. And it reads, "Now there is a great gain in godliness with contentment. For we brought nothing into this world, and we cannot take anything out of the world. But if we have food and clothing, with these we will be content. But those who desire to be rich fall into temptation, into a snare, into many senseless and harmless desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. It is through this craving that some people have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves into many pains." Amen.
Amen.
Good morning, good morning, good morning, good morning. Praise God. Turn your attentions this morning with me to the book of Matthew. I think it's Matthew chapter 6. Good morning, everybody. Those on the line, thank you for those who fellowshipping with us this morning. Thank you for those who couldn't get out of bed but was able to reach over and grab your phone and still receive a word from God. It is such a luxury nowadays to be able to do that. That's such a luxury. Trust me, it is. So many people couldn't make it to church, and God has made a way for people to have church on their phones. He's really reaching nowadays. God is reaching. Yeah. God is really, really reaching with technology and making sure that people get the word. I know a lot of people, older people, I deal with on a daily basis. They say, "I don't fool with the social media. I don't fool with the internet." There are people who believe that because they're not on Facebook, they're better than you and I. You know, but the thing is, God is using social media and platforms of that nature to get His word out. There's some other things that's getting out as well, but God's word is in there as well. So when you see what we think, if people think bad of social media and the internet, God is using that as a tool as well. You can use your page and all those things to glorify God as well. So if you're home and you're receiving the word from God right now, you may not be in church, but good to be able to hear His word this morning. Matthew chapter 6, verse 24. I ask you guys just to mute your phones, keep your conversations down to a minimum in the movement. Verse 24 of Matthew chapter 6 states, "No one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon." Father, we thank You for this word. We thank You for this time, for blessing us and keeping us in all things. Thank You for keeping us, watching over us, praying over Your word right now, knowing it is blessed. Holy Father God, give me the ability to be able to deliver Your word this morning. Praying for the hearts of those that hear it, oh Father God, that they may be locked in and engaged in Your word, that the word may not be stripped or stolen away from them, but it may plant forth seed, oh Lord, and that seed will grow and come back 100-fold in Jesus' name. Amen?
Amen.
I remember having a conversation. A lot of us like to go out to eat, and I remember having a conversation with one of the waiters. I was a young guy, and I'm having a conversation with him. He was telling me in the restaurant, he was saying, "Listen, I'm not making the money I want to make, because right now, since I just started, they have only assigned me to one table. So I'm only able just to serve this table. And when I do grow, they'll give me more tables," right? And that began to speak to me, because what he was saying is that they had only given him one table to serve, until he became more responsible. So that means that him making more money had to do with his responsibilities in serving, right? So here's the thing, if you understand the scripture of teaching with the talents, it said that God gave 1 5, 1 2, and 1 1 based off of their level of responsibility. To whom much is given, much is required. Your level, God's giving is not predicated upon the tithing, it's predicated upon your responsibility in serving. Okay? Because you don't do well serving God with a lot of responsibilities, because correct me if I'm wrong, your responsibilities is keeping you from serving God. And you have not learned how to prioritize your responsibilities, and that's keeping you from serving God. Because the reason why Jesus said you must love me more than father, mother, or any other relationship is because he understands in life there's going to become some distractions that's going to keep you from serving. Now that when he talks about Matthew 6:33, where he talks about putting him first. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and all his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. God was trying to teach us about prioritizing in our serving, right? So what happens is that what God will do, if he feels like our responsibilities is getting in the way of our service, then we start to see some type of lack there. Right? So in the scripture, hear what he was talking about. He says, no one can serve two masters, for either he will love one and hate the other. It's all about in my serving. I don't know about you, but one thing I know that what God will do is that when he wants to get you to a place of serving him, and the scripture was read this morning about the love of money being the root of all evil, God has a way of cutting your money to be able to get your attention. Not that he's not going to give it back, but we know that God will have a way of cutting ours. A lot of us, when it talks about serving money, we serve money and we're trying to serve God at the same time. And what will happen is God will allow certain things to be cut so that we may learn to lean on him for those things. And this is strategically what he does. It's so amazing. When I was thinking about this scripture as well, I was remembering a time when Jesus was talking to the rich man. And the rich man, I believe, was in the book of Matthew chapter 19, where he told the rich man that if he wanted to inherit eternal life, he asked him to sell everything he had, give it to the poor, and he said he would have treasure in heaven. The Bible said that that upset the rich man because he had a lot of things. And Jesus asked him, if you want to have this relationship where you want to be able to get into heaven, he told him, sell everything that he had. But the man had said earlier in the text, he said that he was keeping all the commandments, but Jesus says you're lacking one thing. But if you know anything about the Bible, and I don't want to be long with this, is that the man was able to keep all the commandments that had to do with his relationship with man, but he was breaking the commandment that had to do with his relationship with God. Yeah. You know, something I learned in ministry, and I'm going to get back into this, I just want to make a little footnote. Pastors, people in church think that people who have no problem giving love God a lot. And we think people who don't like to give don't love God. And it's not so on either way. Some of us have more money to give, some of us have more time to give. Right? So, I mean, because I'm going to tell you what, sometimes people don't want to have anything to do with you and they give money. Right? We cash out people quick. Leave me alone. Right? And some of us are serving, dedicated to God, in church, in Bible study, and struggling with our finances. Pastor's looking at you because you don't give like you're supposed to give, but your attendance is high. You give a lot, but your attendance is not here. Depends on what type of ministry you run. That would determine what type of people you want. Do you want people who are consistent in serving or consistent in tithing? That depends if you're running a ministry and if you're running a business. Right? You know, the thing about that, and getting to that teaching as well, was that God, let me tell you, when God wants to grow you up, I'm going to say this, when God wants to grow you up, this is what he has done to me, he'll do to you. He will give you people you can't depend on. Okay? Am I right? When he wants to grow you, he gives you people you can't depend on. And then that's what, I hope it doesn't make you the type of, but then it makes you, sometimes it backfires a little bit because you become that person who say, I don't need anybody. Well, God was giving you people, listen, let me tell you this, great teaching of wisdom. If you know anything about the bodies of water, I believe I'm correct in this, the ocean dumps into seas and seas dump into rivers and rivers dump into creeks and all that, but the ocean never has an issue of anything dumping. It never has a lack. And it's always dumping into somebody else, but nobody understands where does the ocean's water come from. Though the ocean dumps into everything else, God makes sure that the ocean is replenished, though none of those things he dumped into, dump into it. Yeah. Something you and I say, I'm always doing and helping other people. But when I need it. But when I need it, nobody else is helping me. You need to repent because you're wrong. You have lost focus of your source. Because God has always made sure you had or have. But you were looking for it to come back through places he had committed you to dump into, and that's not how God always works. You've done something for people, and next thing you know, a promotion comes on your job. It comes from other places. It doesn't always come from the people you've given to. You're gonna find yourself upset looking for your blessing to come back to the people that you helped. I don't care how much you help people all year long, when they get something, they won't think of you. Somebody got their taxes back or got and didn't pay back none of the money that they owe, but they made sure everybody else was taken care of, but didn't make sure that you were taken care of them. So when I say that, I don't make a mockery of it, but I say that God has given you people that not so much you can't trust in, but you can't depend on, because he was supposed to be your source.
Yeah,
he's supposed to be your source, right? So listen, and with that being said, God is saying, listen, I don't want you trusting in the people. You have to learn to be able to trust in me, right? You have to learn to be able to trust in me, because once people go, you'll always put your trust in people, but if God is your source, you'll always seek him regardless of what it is. He told the man, he says, if you want to be perfect, go sell what you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come follow me. But when the young man heard that saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. The thing is, though, God will cause you at times to choose. Let me tell you what. God asks us to get rid of things that make us mad. That's when you know it's God. See, the thing about it is, if God has asked you to give up something and it doesn't make you mad, I question it if that's God. See, that's why I never, very seldomly, 99% of the time, I don't participate in things like Lent. That's just me. I'm not telling you guys don't do it. Because when, and I try not to make New Year's resolutions because they were already broken. So I try not to participate in Lent, and I'm not offending anyone. But the thing is with Lent, you have chosen something that's easy to give up. You're giving up vegetables. Like, we're forced to eat those, you know. You know, in certain things, but we choose what it is we want to give up. Jesus did not allow the rich man to choose what he wanted to give up. He said, sell everything you have. Everything you have. Give it into the poor. and you will have treasures in heaven. The rich man knew the Bible, but I can tell there's something in this scripture that when you hear it, you don't pick up on it as well. If Jesus tells me to sell everything I have and give it to the poor, and I will have treasures in heaven, I'm still rich. But you don't hear what he's saying, because all you have heard him say was sell all of your possessions. But you have you ever heard the scripture that said, so it is on earth, so it is in heaven, so it is on earth? So if I'm rich in heaven, for I will open up the windows of what? Heaven, and pour you out a blessing. Hold up. First and foremost, if he's talking about having treasures in heaven, that means that here's great teaching. They don't want to teach you this, but this I'll give it to you. Every time I do something to the glory of God, there is a savings or checking account in heaven, okay, that gets placed in heaven because of the works that I do for God. What happens is, like when I go to the ATM to make a withdrawal, I can withdraw from heaven because I've been depositing in heaven. You can't go to the ATM and withdraw what's not there. So when God is telling them in Malachi chapter 3 about tithing and should a man rob God, he's telling them that, listen, when he says render unto Caesar what is Caesar, render to God what is God, he's saying that through your tithing doesn't just produce savings in your earthly bank account, it produces it in heaven as well. So when he's pouring you out a blessing, it's stored up from the works that you have done here on earth. He's rewarding you back. So the rich man was like, listen, I can't see me giving up all of this. But guess what Jesus was? He told Jesus in the word, he said that he kept all the commandments. Well, Jesus tested him right there, showing him that he really didn't love God. Well, he loved God as long as he has his money. See, the thing about it is that I'll teach you, and you may not understand this, but it's easy to love God when things are comfortable. It's easy to serve when it's comfortable. Boy, it's hard to serve when it's uncomfortable. It's easy to jump up and down and praise him how good he is, but it's hard to do that when things are not going good. We serve backwards. When everything is good, we come to church most of the time. Things get wrong, we separate ourselves from the church and wait for things to get back good, then come back to church. I'm not just talking to you, I'm talking to myself. We've learned how to worship God when it's convenient and when it's comfortable. How does one get off track? A lot of times it's through what? Finances. That's why he says the love of money is what? The root of all evil. The man loved God, he knew the scripture, but when it came down to money, he was exposed. God exposes through money both ways, through the adding on or subtracting on. God will give you money, you'll see people for who they are. God takes away money, you see people for who they are. In both instances, God has not changed, he has revealed. It's amazing how he did with the rich man. He asked the rich man to sell everything he had, but then he just took all Job's stuff. He didn't give Job an option. Took everything away from Job. He was, at this point, the reason why he did that with Job is because the devil felt like Job was like the rich man. And the thing about it is that Job was not like the rich man. He had his integrity. He had a real relationship with God. And that's what God was trying to prove to the devil. He was trying to prove to the devil that, listen, regardless of what you take away from Job, he's still going to hold on to his integrity. He's still going to love. He will not curse me. Through this time, I cannot tell you that Job did not get upset. That's what you must understand about the Bible. Job did get upset, but he just didn't curse God. He was definitely upset about the things that had been taken away from him. But let me tell you what God does if you're going through a season of time. If he has taken something away, he's using that opportunity to try to build a relationship with you. Remember God one time told me, I heard the scripture loud and clear. He says, Q, you can't serve God and money. Because you ever find yourself running to the money? Running to the money. 2-3 jobs, running to the money. And you think you're not serving money, but you are serving money. Wherever. And the reason why, you know what God showed me one time? He said, listen, if I had more of you, you can have less jobs. I didn't understand what God meant by that. He said, if I had more of you, you could have less jobs. If I had more of you, you could work less hours. He says, you're working because you love you. You're working because you love money. But the thing about it is that a lot of that, your movement has to do with not having healing. We will serve our addiction. We will do what we have to do for our addiction. I don't mind buying all you guys drinks, but I hate giving. You know, it's different. You know, it's something about giving to God that just, it's a little irritable at times. You know, I don't know what it is, but we all go through this. You know, we'll spend on ourselves, we'll go out, we'll treat everybody, have a good time, but it's that thing with giving to God, right? I don't know what that is. It's amazing because it was the Cain and Abel type of syndrome as well. Abel was one of those type of people who he made Cain look bad through his giving. And God made Cain look bad as well the way he blessed Abel, right? But here, the thing about it is that nobody knew what Abel was sacrificing to be able to be blessed the way he was being blessed. You know, somebody's mad at you right now by the way you're being blessed, not even understand what you sacrificed. I bet you if you told people what it takes to have what you have, they wouldn't even want what you have. When you tell people what time you have to give up in the morning, when you tell people things that you have sacrificed, they say, oh, nah, you can have it. God showed me something most interesting before. I said, God, it's amazing that you always showing people where you taking them, but you never show them what you're going to take them through. And God says, because if I show them what I'll take them through, they'll be discouraged. You know, the powerful thing about it is that when God brought them through Moses out of Egypt, the Bible says that the reason they was taken the way of the Red Sea is because God did not want to take them the way of their enemy, because he knew that when they saw an enemy, because their faith was not strong in him, that they would turn back around. So they ended up at the Red Sea because God had to take them a long way, because he knew that it was something on the short path that was going to cause them to turn back around. He knew their faith wasn't as strong. So God says, let me take them the long way. And by taking them the long way, I'm not going to allow them to run into something that's going to cause them to be able to go back. So God says, I'm going to take them the long way. And they questioned that. They questioned the fact that he was taking them the long way. But he says, I'm doing this basically to help you, because you don't know what's on that path. So if you ever get to a place where you question God about the path that he's taking you, he says in the book of Job, I know the way that I take of thee, for when I have tried thee, you may come forth as gold. God knows the path that you want. He wants you to trust him on this path. There's a reason why it's taking a long time. Your growth will show in what you did for money 10 years ago. You probably wouldn't do it now. You used to probably move for $20. You don't move for $20 anymore. Certain things and money used to make you move, and how you grow, you're like, I'm not moving for that. It's not even worth it. You grow when it's no longer. You know, the thing about it, I was talking to somebody the other day. I said, man, you know what? When you grow in God and you grow in that peace, you turn down positions that pay more just for your peace. You just get comfortable with your peace. And but the thing is, though, you know, with people, I noticed that we're always looking for higher paying jobs, right? And God showed me that one time. He says, Q, you don't necessarily need a higher paying job. Because here's the theory of life. The theory of life is that if you're not making enough money, is to find you a job making more money, not to find out that when you do get the job, when you do get the advance or that job making more money, because of your heart and your level of spending, you'll be back in the same position with just a higher paying job. How is it that I was making $40,000 and now I make over $100,000, but I still have the $40,000 job problems? Because I keep being blessed, but I'm not changing. So therefore, I never have enough. True story that we times loan money to people who make more than us. And that's because you and I have learned how to be good stewards over our money. So it's not how much you make, it's how you serve. Yeah, it's not how much you make. So God says that me giving, it's not that me giving you more is considered, it's considered a blessing. For a man's life does not consist of the abundance of things he possess. He says, you see, we're all looking to make more. But God says, listen, if I have more for you, more from you, you'll be able actually to work less and have more. It doesn't make sense to a lot of people, but there's truth behind that. Amen. God says, let me, if I'm working on you, I tell you what, it's, I don't know if you do this, but when you go through the week and you start to look at self and how much is for you and how much you spend eating out and how much you do this and that, you say, hold up, a lot of money I'm just throwing away. I can actually have what I want if I take some things away from me. I'm just out here eating that car note I could be paying every day. It's not that God isn't providing, it's just that I'm not being a good steward. That's what it is. It's not that God is not providing, it's just that I'm not being a good steward. And what God will do at times, has God ever caused you to, he'll cause you to lose your resource just to find out that he's your source.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. He will put you in a place where you have to fall back on him providing for you and not trusting your resource. Mm-hmm. Yeah, not trusting your resource. The Bible says that we can't put no type of trust in man. Some of you are going through this thing right now with your jobs, and you're getting ready to see how your job feel about you when you don't get vaccinated. You don't get vaccinated, you're going to see how they feel about you. You know, it's a big thing right now. People are just saying, you know, y'all, my job up there, say, listen, vaccination is just not about you. It just shows the concern of people around you, so you should want to get vaccinated. And I said, well, I feel the same way about salvation. Can't make you take that. Put salvation on people. I can't make people accept God.
Yeah.
But you're going to force the vaccine on me. Can't make people. I just can't make people. I can't. People treat you different. The vaccinated are treating the unvaccinated some type of way. I want to do saved people, do that to unsaved people.
Yeah.
Us saved people just going out here treating unsaved people. You saved, and we just put our mask on. But you know that's it's the truth to what's going on. In the Old Testament, those who get into the teachings of the Old Testament, if you had leprosy, do you know that you had to quarantine? This is what we're living in the Old Testament.
Mm-hmm.
Brother Quincy shaking his head because he know. Brother Bruce shaking his head because he know. Back in the Old Testament, if you had caught leprosy or became a leper, they removed you out of the camp.
Yeah.
Right? And what they would do, if you came around and you had leprosy, you happened to go to the store, you used to have to cover your mouth and say, unclean, unclean, unclean. That would be such a benefit to us right now that if people would walk by and say, unclean, unclean, unclean. Then we would, you know, there's a thing on Facebook going on social media right now that you guys are participating in called red flags. Are you guys?
Yeah.
See, if people would just let me know they're unclean, that I wouldn't have to look for the red flags. I will already know that you're unclean. I will already know that you have not been vaccinated. Mm-hmm. So I would know who's clean and unclean. So, and you're going back to the Old Testament, if you had leprosy, when you came around, you would have to cover your mouth and yell unclean. And also, you would have to rip your clothes. Rip your clothes to show that, listen, you're unclean. And then you would have to go quarantine until the leprosy went away. And then, in order to come back into the camp, you had to present yourself to the high priest. Does anybody know what Hebrews says about who your high priest is? The Bible says that we have a high priest who understands what we go through. And he said he sits on the right-hand side of the Father. In Catholicism, they sort of demonstrate what the high priest represents in a fleshly level. But when Christ came and broke that barrier, we no longer had to confess our sins to a priest in the booth. The Bible says that we could boldly go before the throne of grace. Now I don't have to go to a priest. I can just go to the high priest. So if you had leprosy, you had to present yourself to the high priest, and the high priest checked you out, looked at you, and says, okay, now you can go back before the camp, the high priest. But here's the thing. So now, since we're living in the Old Testament, we have the new leprosy. And guess what? Leprosy was a thing as well that they wasn't even sure how people got. You don't even know how you catch COVID. You don't even need to have any symptoms. You can have it. Oh, we're back in the Old Testament. And he says, listen, because you have it, it had nothing even to do with time. Because people in the Old Testament believed that if you was a leper, you'd done something bad. Christian people, good people, are dying from COVID. People that don't know God are dying from COVID. I read some article, they said two type of people come to the hospital with COVID. People that had a vaccination and people that don't. Two type of people die in the world every day. Saved people, unsaved people.
Come on, amen.
We both dying, I just don't want to die unsaved. But if I'm saved, I don't mind dying unvaccinated. What I just said is not going to be popular at all.
Right.
People feel like you're not vaccinated, you're putting everybody else at risk. Well, if you're not saved, you're putting me at risk.
Yeah.
How so was that, Pastor Q? Jonah saved, knowing God, on a ship with a bunch of people who don't know God, put everybody else's life at risk because he was vaccinated and they wasn't. And I say vaccinated, I'm talking about the fact that he knew God and putting everybody else's life at risk.
Amen.
So the unvaccinated people, and I'm using analogy and parable, had to throw Jonah overboard because he was vaccinated. Jonah says, hey, it's okay to expose me to what is overboard because I'm already vaccinated, I'm already saved. You want a boat not saved, so I know I can be thrown over because I know where I'm going to end up. You not so. God is always operating in a way where he would rather take the saved and spare the unsaved. This is just who God is. God says, I can take the saved just so I can spare the lives of the unsaved and give them an opportunity to be able to get it right. You know, the thing about it, people understand too about the story of Jonah is this, is that Jonah got onto a ship of men who were idol worshipers. Idol worshipers. He was the only one who knew God. He was the prophet on the ship. And after he threw himself overboard, the Bible said when the storm came, it had the men on the ship changed from serving or calling out to their idol God to calling on Jonah's God. Look what God will do. He places, though we may find ourselves in a place where there's not a lot of people saved, he always talks about us letting our light shine. I don't know about you, but where God is always placing me, real ministry, what I have learned and what I'm learning is that God doesn't place, he doesn't place his lights all in one place. That's not what he does. Okay? This is actually church services, Bible studies, and all that stuff is basically a recharge. Yes. For the week. It's a recharge. And then God goes and he sends us out. That's all it is. Actually, to be honest, it's not really good, and listen to me when I say this. It's not good. It wouldn't be good to be in church every day. Amen. It wouldn't be good for the world if we're in church every day. But we think that though. So many people take this calling, and I hear people say, you know what? He didn't found the Lord. He don't drink. He don't smoke. He don't go out. And I'm like, whoop dee dee. I just think people like that are missing out on life. Right? Now, that wasn't a line to justify your turn up. But here's what I have found that I thought was pretty bizarre. I've seen people smoking and drinking talking about God. Freely, not even care who they're talking to God around. But people who don't were not high. They were hindered. They didn't feel comfortable talking about God. But somebody was smoking and drinking, and all of a sudden they felt free to talk about God. In a cipher of passing the joint around, somebody was talking about God. There's a stat that shows that more people under the influence feel free talking about God than people under the influence of the Holy Spirit. How is that the influence of the Holy Spirit has made you look at people as if you're better, but the influence of the narcotic made the individual open to freely speak to anybody? Wow. Powerful. He said he used the foolish things of this world to confound the wise. God has not saved me to place me in the place of all saved people, because you got to understand that we all are disciples, and since we are all disciples of God, he places us around people who most of the time are not saved. You're not going to always be around saved people. But church people, we always want to be around church people. And that's why when we have church events, like the women with the bowling thing, like if you tell people it's your church bowling thing, they probably don't want to go. Because I mean, I don't really want to go to church events either. I know it sounds bad, but I don't want to go, because you know how church people are, right?
Like, I don't want somebody looking at what's in that cup, Pastor Q. Ciroc. It's Tito's. What's in yours? You just, you know, okay, drink your ginger ale. Fine. No, you got service in the morning. I know. I don't, I'm gonna be there. My attendance is pretty good here, looking at my Saturday nights. I tell you what, this is such a great teaching, and I probably shouldn't say this because I can say this because I'm mature, right? But if you go a place and you're a Christian, right? You know that's how I do some people sometimes. I go places, people know I'm a pastor, and they don't walk, I know everybody know I'm a pastor. I said, let me get some of that Ciroc. And everybody like. So listen, Paul said, I become all things to all men that I may win souls for Christ. Listen, I'm not justifying, but listen, that shot of Tito is gonna break the ice in the room for me. That shot ain't gonna hurt me. I'm 270 pounds, maybe 4 or 5 shots of. Made me feel a little warm, but what I'm trying to say is that I'm not influencing anybody. But what I'm trying to tell you is that when you walk in a place, people have their defenses up because of who you are. Maybe that works more so for me, but the Bible teaches me as well in the opposite. See, you can have and do what you want to do in the privacy of your own home. Well, some people think that way, but that's another thing. But you can do what you want to do in the privacy of your own home. But the Bible says that do not be a stumbling block to anyone.
Yeah,
now, I may not have a problem with a glass of red wine, but if I invited somebody over who had an issue with drinking, I should hold back on my red wine until they leave. But it works the opposite way around. When we see, listen, I care more about breaking the ice in the room that I may minister than walking into the room and trying to present myself faultless. See, that's why y'all can't do real ministry, right? Because when y'all go places, you're more concerned about how you look for the people. Yeah. Than actually how many people you one for God.
Yeah.
Nope, you're set there, you're saved, you're sanctified, and everybody know who your pastor is and what church you go to, and they don't say nothing around you, they're uncomfortable. This is not a reason, I have not given you reason to hit the J today, that's not what I'm saying. but if you mustn't, and hitting the J doesn't cause you any conviction. The Bible said, he who knows to do wrong, who knows to do right, and does it not to him it is sin. Guys, when they pass you, is weed wrong? I said, do you feel bad when you do it? I feel good. I say, well, if you talk to God and he has not yet convicted you, come on now. One thing I hate about being a pastor, like the trick questions. people know you're a pastor. I said, listen, it really doesn't matter how I feel about it. What does God say about it? If you can't look, Pastor, you said he didn't think it was wrong. Right or wrong. It's not my word. How do you feel when you do it? You know when you do something wrong. Get back and read code. Matthew chapter 6. No, and so he started off saying, listen, who is your master? No one can serve two masters, for either he will hate one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. Going back to my beginning of my story, the young guy serving tables. He had said that they had taken some tables around from him because he found out he couldn't serve, he wasn't good at serving a whole bunch of tables. They had to take some of his tables away. And that showed me what God will do if we don't know how to prioritize and learn how to serve. God start taking tables away. I always know when God is punishing me, he takes things away. He said he chastised those whom he loved. I don't care what happens. Me, I think sometimes I'm over spiritual though. Because if I get a nail in my tie, I immediately equate that with something. I look up in the heaven like, what are you trying to say today? Check engine light, come on, what are you saying? I'm just that spiritual. Something go wrong, I look into the heaven, what are you saying today? Does this mean don't leave the house? You know, can't find my keys. God, is that you saying don't go? Looking for a reason not to go, right? I didn't want to go anywhere, right? God, is that you saying, you know, overly spiritual? Or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. Mammon is God and money. You can't serve both of them. You know, last scripture, I'll close off this one. Deuteronomy chapter 8 talks about when you obey God, he said that these things will overtake you. Meaning that you don't have to chase them. These things just come and overtake you. These things find you. You basically said, and in so many words, you may hear people say, what do you say? You don't have to chase the money. If you do what you're supposed to, the money will find you. That's the favor of God. It will find you. You know, it's amazing because even people who love money, they mark it with money. Let me tell you what, for all the red flag people this week, the red flag in ministry is when you meet someone and they're telling you how God wants to bless you. It's a red flag. It's a red flag. Because God does not open conversations with blessings. He opens conversations with serving. Yeah. Most people on this platform, they come in and tell you how God wants to bless you. God is looking for those to worship him in spirit and in truth. All that stuff comes along. But God is just, God, you don't have to draw people in telling them that God is going to bless them. You don't have to do that. That is a red flag. Because if you're drawn by that, if somebody has to draw you in that way, if you don't get the blessing, then you're not going to be kept. Mm-hmm. But if you come in as a servant and a worshiper, regardless of what circumstances happen, you won't change anything. You won't be moved. You won't be moved at all. And the thing about, he tests us by seeing, will we still worship him when circumstances change?
Yeah,
that's what he does. He says, I'm testing you to see that if I change your circumstances, will you still be a worshiper? Mm-hmm. Let us thank you. Father, we thank you for this word. We thank you for this time. Bless us, keep us in all things. Thank you, Lord, for seeing us through. In Jesus' name we pray, we thank you. Amen. Let's give the Lord a hand of praise. Amen.